woke up at the clock when I started to see how much time I had left. And so I sort of felt like I was rushing. And then Ben puts the video on, and it was 37 minutes. And I was like, oh my gosh, I spoke for, I'm so sorry. He said, what do you mean sorry? That's the shortest sermon we've had all year. So hopefully I won't change that too much today. But, you know, as this week went along, I was really reminded of the words that I shared with you last time I was here a little over a month ago. And Greg kept sending me these text messages asking me to do more. And would you do this? And, you know, the first response that I have as a human is, geez, I'm already preaching. Isn't that enough? And then I kind of went back to the words that I said, when you're asked to serve and God has gifted you, how do you say no? And so very simply, my answer to his questions. And he said, you know, no is a full sentence and completely acceptable. And my response was that it's really a honor to be asked, and it's a privilege to serve. And that's what we have to think about as we are believers in God's kingdom. It is a privilege that he has called us to him. It's a privilege to serve him. And if you get to the point in life where even you're recognized for that servanthood, that servant heart in you, that's because God is working in you. And so I would just re-encourage you again that if you were ever asked to serve in any capacity, the response should be, it's a privilege to serve. And so this morning, we're going to talk about joy, which comes out of servanthood. And when I was asked to give this word, I love this word. I think it's probably one of the best words that fits with Christmas for many of us. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. You know, it's that joy, it's sort of that thing that we're all seeking, we're looking for. We look internally, we try to find joy. And if I asked you today and went around the room and said, would you define joy for me? You would all have a different answer. But often, it's about something about how we feel. And joy is usually the thing that we look for before we change. And so I'm not going to be in a good Christmas spirit until I feel joyful. And then I will be joyful for other people. How often do we feel that way? If we're in a bad mood, how easy is it for us to show joy to somebody else? You get fired at work and then somebody calls you. You know, how easy is it to give joy right away? No, we like to wallow in the opposite of joy so often. And we wait for joy to come about before we begin to respond to joy. And I'm going to challenge you this morning as we go into the book of Romans. We're going to be in the 12th chapter, not the second chapter, in the 12th chapter, and we're going to start on verse 9. And the Apostle Paul is writing this to the church in Rome. And at the top in the ESV, it says, marks of the true Christian. And so I'm going to challenge you this morning to take out the word Christian and put in marks of true joy. And the challenge this morning is that we so often, again, we're looking for joy to happen first, for us to experience something that makes us joyful, and then we will begin to be joyful. And I'm going to challenge you this morning that what Paul is saying is that Christ brought us joy, and we are to live more and more like Christ every day. And when you live more and more like Christ, you will then experience joy. Joy. We look externally all the time for joy when God has said, I've sent my son that joy might live within you. And so the challenge this morning to you as we go through this is stop looking to your friends, your neighbors, your experiences, your job, your entertainment as joy, and start looking within yourself to find where joy is sparked. And Paul is giving a great lesson here. He's saying, I'm going to give you sort of a guidebook. You do this, 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 and this, and I promise you that you will have the marks of a true Christian and the marks of true joy. Joy is the second fruit of the Spirit, so that means that joy doesn't come from an experience. It comes from God. His Spirit is when we receive joy. You know, the definition of joy is the emotion of great delight or happiness caused by something exceptionally good. In your lives, how much are you looking for things that are caused by mere happiness? Think about the things that bring us joy. We see a movie on TV and, oh, we're so joyful. Joy is not happiness. And that's, I think, the thing that we forget all the time. We can be joyful and unhappy at the same time. Joyfulness is the outpouring of Christ in you. And Scripture doesn't say that, you know, you're always going to be happy. As a matter of fact, I think we see times where it says you're not going to be. We're going to suffer often for the gospel. But in suffering, you can still be joyful. They're two very different things. And we often equate happiness and joy together. And the Apostle Paul is saying, regardless of your happiness or your sadness or any of those things, that you can live within true joy. When tragedy strikes, you know, like 9/11, for instance, I remember serving down in Grand Rapids in 9/11, and being a pastor down there, when this happens, there's very few answers that we have. And people ask all the time, how can a God of love do this? How can he allow something this to happen? He, you know what? You can be sad, angry, and confused, but at the same time, you can praise God in the storm because you have joy within you. And Paul is saying in this, and we're going to start in the first verse, he said, let your love be genuine. And that word genuine is something that we often take for granted. He's not saying, you know, let your love be kind of okay. He's saying, let it be genuine. Let it come from the depth of you and let it be real. Let it not put on that facade that people have all the time, and they're gritting their teeth while they're shaking somebody's hand, and they're you know, that's not what he's saying. He's saying if you want to be joyful, if you want to experience joy in your life, then start with letting your love be genuine. You know, genuine love is sacrificial love. When you look at your spouse and you're frustrated with things, are you sacrificing for them? Are you giving up what you want for something they want? Let your love be sacrificial, and you will experience joy. And I heard once from a pretty wise guy. I was at one of the churches I served in Illinois. He's about 83, 84 at the time, and he shared with me right before my wedding that, you know, marriages that end, all of those marriages end with a beginning that starts with something very, very, very minor. The toilet paper roll backwards, dishes left in the sink, trash not taken out. All ending marriages start with something very minor. And because that's a marriage that does not pertain sacrifice. If you think about it, and he said to me, here's the best piece of advice I can give you. And for anybody in this room who's married, I've only been married for 4 years, so I'm not the expert, but I can tell you this, that if you consider everything you say before it comes out of your mouth when it comes to marriage, and you say, am I willing to lose my marriage over this? Then speak and see how often you speak. And it's because the question is, are you willing to live your marriage sacrificially? Is what you're asking yourself. Does my desire, my need, does that matter more? So I challenge you this morning, if you wanted to begin to experience true joy, start loving one another sacrificially, which means your needs don't come first. God's desire for this world didn't come first. Do you think he really wanted to send his son to die and hang on that cross? That wasn't his desire for this world, but he loved us sacrificially enough to send his son. And if that right there, I could stop right there. Really. I mean, that right there should give us joy that will take us forever. But Paul isn't finished. He says, abhor what is evil, hold fast to what is good. So he's saying, hate evil. And then instead of, you know, gossiping about evil and bad things and all of this, hang on to what is good in life. Instead of coming home from work at the end of the day and listing off all of your complaints and frustrations for the day, how about you find that one nugget of enjoyment and speak about that for an hour at dinner? Imagine what that would do to your day and to your life. He's saying, if you want to experience joy, stop focusing on the negative and embrace and boast in the positive. Verse 10, he says, love one another with brotherly affection. Loving one another means be devoted to one another. Again, this is a step beyond the doing. This is the experiencing of God. He's not saying just, you know, hang out and go to the mall with some people you kind of know. He's saying be devoted to them. When they're in crisis, when they're dealing with loss, a friendship, a death in the family, something, any of these things, don't just kind of be gentle. Be devoted to them. Seek their needs. Love them, and you will experience joy. Are you getting the point here that it's not about what we get to get joy? It's about what we do produces joy. We look externally all the time for joy. And that's why people have addiction and broken marriages and destroyed relationships, because they're looking to the external when instead they're not living a life of joy. It says, outdo one another in showing honor. Think about that for a minute. What if we could, what if we spent the next month, and I challenged everybody in here, outdo each other? You know, David, you do something great, and I'm going to try to outgrade him in the goodness and make it better. And then, you know, he goes over to somebody else and does something wonderful. I mean, could you imagine what would happen if we began to outdo each other in showing honor to one another as opposed to looking for reasons to tear them down? You know, David said last time after I spoke, he said, I'm a really big guy. That was how he first met, you know. And I laughed at that for a minute. I thought, well, you know, I guess for me, the opposite of that, I guess to outdo him in honor would be say he's a really small guy. You know, but no, it's outdoing one another in honor, lifting somebody else up. And instead of finding a way to say, I'm better than you, find a way to say, you have blessed me and you have made me better because of it. If you walked around looking for that in people, do you think you would have joy in your life? Would that bring about joy? Again, we're getting a response of joy from what God has given instructions to us. We are to be more like Christ every day, and the more we are like Christ, the more we will experience joy. I mean, it seems so simple. When I'm reading through this, and I've preached this before, and my wife has heard me preach it before, this is not what I preached the last time. It wasn't about joy. It was about a list of things. But we experience joy from God when we begin to live more like him, as opposed to waiting until Christmas to sing these carols that give us warm fuzzies. And, you know, we think back to the experience of childhood. And, oh, you know, somebody's got a favorite movie or a favorite song or a favorite experience. And when we think about that experience, we then have joy. We don't need to wait on something to happen to experience joy in our lives. In verse 11, Paul says, do not be slothful in zeal. The word zeal there is interesting for me. That's, you know, he's saying, do not be slothful or do not be slow to exacerbate the excitement of God. Be quick to just shout God's name from everywhere you can to everybody who can, who cares what they think. It doesn't matter. He is saying, do not be slothful. Be excitement in your zeal for God. When you are passionate about God, there are people that in this room that I know that just exude this passion for God, and you see it all the time, and you're like, oh, geez, come on. How can you possibly be in that good of a mood all the time? It's because that person is excited about what God has done in their lives. Paul is saying to this church, you have been given the gift of salvation. And we don't talk about this very often. I mean, it's the gift of the opposite of hell. An opportunity to expend the rest of eternity in the presence of God versus a place void of God. And he's saying, don't hold back and tell that to other people. I say it in the goosebumps. I mean, we have the opportunity to know Christ, and because of that, spend eternity living with God, worshiping him and glorifying him and praising him. And he's saying, if you believe this, go out and tell everybody and don't be slow about it, because you will experience joy in your heart and in your life. He says, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, be constant in prayer. There's a lot of words in there. We talk in this Advent season about hope coming. Hope is here. We live it. We breathe it. We know it. And he says, rejoice in it. Don't wait for hope to come. Hope has come. Some 2,000 years ago, the Son of God hung on a cross, and we sang the words earlier, those nails that were meant for me went through his arms and his wrists, and that brought hope to this world. And for some reason, we seem to wait until Christmas to get hopeful about this. That hope is there in March and May and June and every other month of the year. And Paul is saying, rejoice in that. Share it with people. When you're rejoicing and happy about something, if I called one of you up this week and said, I've got some news for you. I wasn't expecting to be able to tell you this, but I have a brand new car for you. Mercedes-Benz, just go down over there and pick it up. How many people would you have called between leaving the house and getting to the Mercedes-Benz dealership? And when the cops stopped you along Airport Road, what would you have told him? Would you have told him, I just want a new car, I got to get right down the Mercedes? Absolutely you would have. And what Paul is saying is, when that cop stops you in Airport Road, the first thing out of your mouth is, I have salvation because of Jesus Christ. And I am joyful because of that. And it is a privilege and a joy to share with you the true reality of this world. He's saying, in times of difficulty and tribulation and challenge, be patient. We want so quickly to get through our trouble. We want to bridge over the trouble as quickly as we can and get onto it. But God says, be patient. And he also says other places in his word, in your storm, we are to praise him. You know, Greg prayed this morning, and actually last Sunday, and it kind of struck me. He thanked God for the illness that he had. He's been waiting all year to do Selah. It's something that he's wanted to do. He feels it on his heart to do. He's done it for 12 years. And he couldn't sing at Selah. And what does he do? Well, I tell you what I would have done. I'd been pretty ticked off. I probably canceled it or, you know, whatever. I would have been less enthusiastic about it. But he thanked God for his illness. And he asked God if he could learn what he needs to learn that God gave it to him for. Greg was exhibiting joy. Even in tribulation, you can have joy. And then Paul reminds us, as he does many, many, many times, be constant in prayer. How often do we feel we've heard from God and then we ignore him? Do you get a direction from God, you make a path, you make a life decision, and then you stop asking God for direction on that? You're looking to make a job change. God, please give us direction, guide us. And we all know the words. We've all said the words. And then we get the new job, and then we forget to praise God for it, and then we forget to continually go back to God for continued direction along the way. Paul is saying, be constant in prayer. In verse 13, he says, contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. The saints were God's people. And one of the things that Christ Church is involved in is the community pantry here. That is one of the just simple ways that we can do what Paul is saying here, is that we can contribute to the saints. You know, we too often think we need to qualify a person's need before we're willing to give to them. I've done it. I've been in ministry for years, and I couldn't tell you the number of times people come knocking on the door for a handout. And for some reason, we think it's our money, and for some reason, we think that it's our place to sort of qualify the need. That's not what Paul is saying here. He doesn't say, you know, figure out if somebody's really needing it or not. If somebody comes to you and asks you for a need, Paul is saying, show it. Give it to them. Contribute to them. It's not our money anyway. It's not our resources anyway. And but for the grace of God, there go I. I grew up in poverty. I don't know if I've shared this story really with you guys, but I grew up in extreme poverty. My mother, I had a half-brother and half-sister. We lived above a bar. We didn't have a bathroom or a kitchen or anything in the room we lived in. And I can remember distinctly these people coming at Christmas with a box full of food. I have no idea who they were. They weren't connected to our family at all, but it's a church that knew we were in need. The hard part was we didn't have an oven to cook the turkey, but there was a turkey in the box. And so he's saying here in this that if we want to experience joy, start contributing to the needs of other people. When you're at the grocery store, at whatever store it is, and you're checking out, and they're saying, hey, do you want to give a dollar to da-da-da-da? Instead of being embarrassed for saying no or feeling uncomfortable for saying no, how about we do 10? because I have 10 to give and there are people who are in need. And giving that 10 will give me joy. For some reason, we hoard it all to ourselves. And Paul is saying, help to meet the needs of other people. Seek to show hospitality. Hospitality is a big word in Scripture. We hear it a lot. In Judaism, and I'm not going to pronounce this well, hakasant orchim is the Jewish word for hospitality. It means welcoming guests. It's based largely on the example of Abraham in the book of Genesis. When Abraham greeted guests, they were treated royally. We don't seek anymore in this day and age to show true hospitality. In the Greek, hospitality in Greece, or the ancient Greek, hospitality was a right. We make it something that is earned. When somebody comes to your house to fix your refrigerator, how do you treat them? When they walk out of your house, would they know you were any different than somebody who didn't know who Christ was? We don't show hospitality anymore the way Paul had asked. You know, we know the story, there was no room in the inn. People simply at times went to people's houses and knocked on the door and asked for a place to stay. And in Jewish times, it was an honor to welcome a stranger into your home and give them a place to stay. Now we're afraid to open our door for somebody we don't know. And we are wondering why we're losing joyful lives. What do you think, after you felt safe, if a stranger walked to your door and said, do I have a place to stay? Imagine if you said yes and began to show that person hospitality, shared your meal with them, made sure that they had a bed to sleep in that was comfortable. Beyond the safety factor that is real, and you felt safe, do you think you might begin to feel a little joy? Paul is saying in here, start living these things out. Show hospitality and you'll feel good. There are people in this room that have the gift of hospitality. Ruth is one of them. Some of you guys know I'm a big fan of Ruth, but mostly it's because she's my assistant at Traverse City Christian. And she keeps me very, very well organized. And she actually makes me look really good because a couple times a month, she shows up at school with this plate of desserts and takes them to the manager's meeting and says they're from me. She frankly doesn't do it enough, but no, she, you know, her, one of her gifts that she enjoys is creating food, but it's not that, it's creating joy for people. She's not creating it to eat, she's creating it to give away. And so she's showing hospitality. She's helping to meet somebody's needs for hunger, but you know, what does that do for her? Everybody at the table is scarfing those things down. Do you think that that doesn't bring joy to Ruth? It's about hospitality. It's about loving each other. It's about going the extra mile as the minimum, not the maximum for somebody. Hospitality, all of these things, the ferventness in prayer, the patience in tribulation, the zeal for God, none of these things should be special in our lives. And that's what Paul is saying. If you want joy on a daily basis to be part of your life, to permeate your family, to permeate your life, then you have to live these every day. And then hospitality is going to be something you do when you wake up because you don't even think about it. It needs to be a habit in life. But we take these things and we put them up on a pedestal and then we, you know, I'll give you an example. A few years ago, I was serving a church in Illinois, and we had some problems at the church. They were really not very hospitable. They were really great to each other, but a guest would ever walk in, and somebody at the worship committee meeting started sharing how, you know, hey, I've greeted people before. You know, this Sunday, there was a new family, and I walked up to them, and I greeted them. You know, he was bragging about it, and my response was, why is that even significant? What about the 300 other visitors that came in the last 3 or 4 years that weren't greeted that way? It should not be special. It should be a standard that every person that walks through Christ Church doors are greeted hospitably and feel welcomed here. That should not be special. And it's certainly not something we brag about. Hey, I greeted somebody. Did you hear? I didn't make this up. This is a true conversation. Because we have gotten so far away from the teachings of Paul on this that we say, oh, to be you know, I was nice to somebody today. What do you mean nice to somebody? Did you invite that person to dinner? Did you say to that person, thanks for coming, is there something I can do for you? How can I be in prayer for you? I noticed your son walked in today without a coat on. We have a clothing room. Is there a coat I can get for you? No, we brag about shaking somebody's hand. And then we wonder why we live through a season and we go, we can't find joy. I'm looking for it everywhere and I can't find it. In verse 14, he says, bless those who persecute you. This is right here. I mean, I could probably preach for like 10 years on this, and it won't sink into most of us. It is not easy. I'll be honest, I'm the same way. Get fired from a job and try to boast about that person. Could you imagine what our community of just Traverse City was like if we blessed those who persecuted us? And blessing is really kind of the key word there. It's that, you know, the definition of bless is to request of God the bestowal of a divine favor. Get fired from work, walk out to your car with your box that security has escorted you to, get in the car and say, Father God, thank you for your son, and may that man be blessed in a way that I can't imagine. I'm not saying I've done it. This is my rule book too. You know, sometimes we think, you know, people instruct us as pastors. You know, a lot of times we pastors preach on things that we need to work on. Would you say that's fair? So if you want to know what we're dealing with in our life, maybe this is what I, you know. But we, you know, we so often, that, and that's probably the most truth I'm going to speak all day right there, is that I'm not perfect. By far, I'm a sinner as good or better than you. But this is what Paul is saying. He's giving us a benchmark to live. Bless those who persecute you and see how much joy you have at the end of the day. See if your life will be different, because you're not going to go home and wallow in it. You're going to practice hospitality and invite a friend out to dinner. You're going to go serve somebody because you're trying to honor God with zeal. He says, bless those who persecute you and bless and do not curse them. See, that's the second part. The first part's hard enough, but then it says after that that you're not supposed to talk about the way that somebody wronged you. You're not supposed to challenge yourself. And I'm, again, this is right here for me. I could spend the rest of my life working on this and it's going to be a challenge. I'm a justice guy. I believe in right and wrong, and I don't like wrong. I don't like when somebody's been wronged. It's just, that's for me. And I wallow in it. And I sit there. If you've been wronged, I'm your best friend. Because I'll come alongside of you and I'll sit there and wrong, point out all the ways it's wrong. And so for me, this is where God is saying to me, you've got to live differently. You've got to bless those who persecute you and then don't talk about it. You know, people who persecute you, that's the other thing, too, that we focus on. These are not just people who talk bad about you or who aren't really nice to you. Those are people that it's easy to sort of live over or pray over. These are people who have wronged you. Think of persecution the way those American Christians who were beheaded were persecuted. And Paul is saying to the wives of those husbands, you need to honor them and praise God for them. And ask God to bless them, those people who just took your husband's life. Paul's not saying this is going to be easy. He never once has Paul ever said, hey, this is going to be easy. Look what Paul went through. Look at his persecution. And in the midst of all his persecution, he wrote a huge portion of the Bible. In the midst of imprisonment and punishment at levels that most of us in this room could not even live through, he praised God and he wrote these words. He said, rejoice with those who rejoice. We're good at that. When things are going good for other people, we love a celebration. We'll find reasons to, you know, we even will brag on other people's success. We like to do that. But the next one for us as believers is a little bit more difficult. It says, weep with those who weep. It doesn't say try to console those people who weep. It doesn't say when somebody is challenged and struggling, go to them and just tell them it's going to be all right and find all of those little words throughout Christianity that we, you know, God is good all the time and all the time God is good. You know, God will never give you anything that you can't handle. No, that's not true. God will never give you anything that with him you cannot make it through. But he gives us stuff all the time that we cannot accomplish on our own. Constantly, daily, we are given things that we cannot accomplish but for the grace of God. And he's saying when your brother and sister is in pain, go with them and be in pain with them. Experience their pain and understand it. He doesn't say, go wash it off and tell them to get over it. He says, you, brothers and sisters, need to love each other enough to be hurt when somebody, your brother and sister, is hurt. Because sitting there with somebody in pain with somebody will bring you joy. And it will bring that other person joy because somebody is trying to learn to experience with them what they're experiencing. We want to get over this, and we want to have a happy life. And let's, you know, somebody loses somebody in their life, and let's move on. It's time to move on. Sit with them, be with them, love with them, weep with them. When you show that you are in pain when somebody else is, they look to you with a love that cannot be expressed. When it's true pain, when it's true, my wife's grandmother passed away 2 years ago, Christmas Eve, and I had to speak the funeral a couple days after Christmas. And, you know, in the middle of the funeral service, I just started crying. And then, of course, everybody else in the room started crying. And, you know, we were all wallowing in our own weeping sadness together. But, you know, it wasn't that I knew her grandmother very well, because she had Alzheimer's the entire time I've met her. I'd only spoken to her once or twice before she was completely gone from us. But it was the connection I had to the family and the pain that they were experiencing that was brought on me. And to love people enough to feel their pain. Now I'm going to sit here and cry. But that's what God wants from us. To love people enough to understand their pain. What joy would you begin to have in life when you began to experience each other's life with that depth of gratitude for each other, to open yourself up to the loss and the pain of somebody else's life? Somebody's in pain, go sit down next to them and just cry with them. Don't say a word. And 3 or 4 months later, ask that person if that was helpful, and I guarantee you they will say every time yes. This is what Paul is asking from us. Love each other enough to do that. You'll make it through all the other hurt and all the other challenges. He said, live in harmony with one another. That's pretty easy to understand. Get along. Let's stop looking for the things that separate us and start looking and celebrating the things that bring us together. It says, live in harmony with one another and do not be haughty, but associate yourself with the lowly. If you look down at the bottom in the ESV, if you've got a study Bible, it says, or give yourselves to humble tasks. How many of us have achieved a place in life where we don't think we should do that anymore? How many of you guys work in a place that has a custodian? Anybody? A custodian? When was the last time you took the trash out at work? Sometimes it's, well, we got somebody else to do it. Sometimes I'm the president of the company. I'm the CEO. Can I put you on the spot? You were president of Herman Miller. How many times did you take out the trash? Yeah, and Kerm is an example. Kerm is a man in our community that is known to love God and to put his mouth and his resources and his heart into it. And it doesn't say take out the trash once. It's taking out the trash long enough that you can be an example to others. none of this is particularly glory, you know, for us on earth. You know, Paul didn't say get all high and mighty, achieve success, and, you know, compound your riches and hang around with rich people. You know, Paul has challenged us to do the opposite, and this is what Christ Church is about. It's about getting out in the community and being with the people, not the people. And when you're out serving those people, I'll tell you what, you want to feel joy, go into work and take the trash out for the custodian. Walk by him in the hall as he goes, "What are you doing?" "Oh, I thought I would just help you today. It was a lot more trash, and it's my trash, it's not yours. I'm going to take it out." He might ask what was in your trash that you didn't want him to see, but, you know, you'll figure that part out later. He says, never be wise in your own sight. And I spent, and this is in the second half of verse 16, he says, never be wise in your own sight. And I really thought I understood this phrase, you know. And then I started to really look this week at it. And it's found at least two other times in Scripture. In Proverbs 3:7, it says, do not be wise in your own eyes. In Isaiah 5:21, it says, woe to those who are wise in their own eyes. So, you know, Paul's saying, do not be wise in your eyes. And I get, okay, we should change. And then, you know, Isaiah is saying, woe to those. So, woe. This means this is not good for us to be wise in our own eyes. And, you know, I looked through lots of descriptions of what it meant to be wise in your eyes. And there's a lot of different examples of what it means to be wise in your eyes. It says, but here's the point. What Paul is teaching here is contrary to we sinful people. I'm a sinner by nature. I am not generous by nature. My generosity to Greg to fill in today is not my natural nature. My nature is, don't you think I'm doing enough, Greg? Preaching isn't enough. Does anybody else come to Christ Church and preach and lead worship? And, you know, that is my nature. And that is probably a response that if I gave, most of you in the room at some level would get. And you'd probably say, you know what, that's kind of right. I can't believe, you know, Greg, I can't believe you even asked him to do that. You know, you know, it's so easy for us. And we can even relate to that. And what they're saying here is, and Paul is saying here is, you know what? None of this is normal to you. Most of this doesn't make sense. A lot of this doesn't seem like it's going to feel very good. You know, I've worked really hard, you know, to get to the level. You know, Kerm could have easily said, you know, I've worked a long time to work to this level, and I sacrificed a lot, and I've got somebody else who can do that for me. And a lot of us would get that, and some of us might even respect that as a thought process. But he didn't do that. And Paul is saying in this here, he's saying, you don't make the rules, and you don't get to decide what is right and wrong. You must look to God's word for direction. And so if you don't like these rules, I'm sorry. This is what Paul is saying to live a Christian life, and what Paul is saying, if you want to live in joy, you must be willing to live out these rules, and you don't get to decide if the rules are right, fair, just, or good. But if you live them out, you will have joy in your life. And so as we continue on, it says, don't be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no evil for evil. That's hard. But Paul is saying, don't get back at somebody. You know, Christ Church is actually a pretty good example of living this out. Some of you may or may not know that at the same time that Christ Church was going through the challenge that Christ Church did a little more than a year ago, Faith Reformed Church, where I was serving, went through the exact same thing. And I was here the day that you guys launched because I was going through the same thing at Faith Reformed Church. And it was so tempting and so easily tempting to want to destroy the church on your way out. That's the sin within me. And my wife and I made a conscious decision not to find another church home to anchor to, so that people that were leaving the church I was at over the problem would not follow us to another church. We were asked if we were going to start a church because we had enough people to start a church. And for us, it was about living and speaking into the community. And so we came and found another body of people. And that first Sunday, half this room was full of Faith Reform people that came here. But in that, there were opportunities for us to really do damage. We had the information that we knew and the knowledge that we had. And it's the same with the leaders that started here. The opportunity to return evil with evil was so prevalent in this community, not just with Christ Church and Faith Reform, but lots of churches that literally leaders of us got together and said, we know that God is doing something. It was so huge. And we had the opportunity to return evil with evil, and it would have felt so good. But it wouldn't have felt joyful. See, it was our feeling good and joy are two separate things. And Christ Church today stands as an example of not returning evil with evil. People came at every angle trying to get stuff from the leaders of this church, trying to get leaders of this church to say bad things. And what happened was that a healthy church was formed out of it. Because evil was not returned with evil. It's incredible to know that you guys in this room experienced this out, literally, in true ways, and you've seen the blessing that God has given because of it. Paul says, do not return evil with evil. He says, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all on you. And that really was what the leadership here at Christ Church did and what my wife and I did when we left Faith. We decided to give honor to God in it. And instead of saying to the public and to the community horrible things, we said, this is God's plan. And there are now two congregations who are serving the community in two separate ways. And God's kingdom is better because of it. It says, so far as it depends on you, and that's the part that we kind of forget there, so far as it depends on you, you don't got to figure it out for everybody else. You don't need to figure out for Jeff what he should or shouldn't say. Paul is saying to you, where so far as it counts on you, so far as you have the ability to control it, live this way. Stop worrying about what other people are doing. Stop looking over at your husband and wife and saying, hey, you should have done this differently. So far as it depends on you, live this way. Don't share evil for evil. Don't give evil for evil. It doesn't honor God and it doesn't bring you joy. He said, live peaceably with all. And now here comes Paul back again, showing you after this, because this is really an admonition. Obviously, the church in Rome wasn't living this way or Paul wouldn't have had the need to write this letter. And he reminds them that he loves them. And he says, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. We so want to be in that role. Our sinful nature, we want to lash out at people. We want so much in our lives to get somebody back for what they've done to me. Heaven forbid somebody ever do something to my daughter, because I'm not going to remember this verse. Except for the fact that God says it is his place. It is his place to cast judgment. It is his place to cast punishment. And so we see this in our lives acted out every once in a while in the news. You'll hear about somebody who lost a child to gun violence. And then the parents of the child come on TV and say, I forgive them for what they've done. And we don't understand that. How could you? I mean, they're living out Apostle Paul's teaching right there by forgiving. Because you know what? You're not going to be able to get rid of that anyway in your own selves. So if you give it to God and forgive, I promise you, you will feel more joy than if you wallow in your anger and frustration and challenge and furiousness for the rest of your life. Paul is saying, give it to God, let him take care of what he says, and you will experience joy in your life. In the midst of the tragedy of loss, you will experience joy if you live this way. And then in verse 20, this is, I love it. I have this written in the thing here. It says, what I write is, this whole passage is contrary. But now Paul is going to the contrary. Like, all of this other stuff should be natural to us. And now it's going to, now we're going to get to the challenging part. I just, every time I've read through this, it always strikes me. I've got contrary circled, it's highlighted. I've got these notes all around it, trying to figure out what isn't contrary for me in this. But he says, to the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For in doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. This phrase, I'm going to share a story. I preached this sermon last November at a church in Alma, and I'd never had an experience before preaching where somebody argued with me in the middle of a sermon. Has that ever happened to you? And I said that, you know, there are a couple of kind of schools of thought on this phrase, but there's no real clear understanding of what this means exactly. And he's like, no, that's not true. I'm like, I thought I was actually candidating. And so I thought it was a test, you know, and I really didn't know what to do. And, you know, he's arguing with me that I'm wrong. And so I'm like, well, thank you for that. And kept going on. But there really is no clear understanding. This term actually shows up one other time in Scripture. It's back from Solomon in Proverbs 25, 21, and 22. It says, if your enemy is hungry, give him bread to eat. If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. For all shall heap coals of fire upon his head, and Jehovah shall reward you. So one of them, and the one I really like, is that... and I think it's probably the one that if we take away, we'll enjoy maybe a little bit more for us, or have joy in it, is that, you know, if you want to irk somebody who's mad at you, what's the worst thing you can do to them? Kill them with kindness, right? We hear it all the time. And so I look at this and say, maybe this is what Paul is saying here, is that kill your enemies with kindness. Show them hospitality. It's going to irk them because they're looking for in you sin. They're looking for something to say, you know what, Sherry? You know, she's not really as nice as she seems when I was, you know. No, kill them with kindness. It's going to infuriate them. It's going to drive them nuts. Isn't that like the ultimate, you know? God is saying, if you want to play a part in making a change in somebody's life and experiencing joy, when they do wrong to you, turn around and treat them with kindness. Love them. Care for them. Understand that what you have a problem with is sin in their life. It's not that you don't like them, it's that you're not liking the sin that they're showing out. And then remember, pause and remember that you have that same sin. Imagine what joy you would have this Advent season if over the next week you worked to live out what the Apostle Paul is saying. In the last verse, he says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. That's what all Paul is saying here. In everything you do, we are sinners. We were born into sin. We have no way around it. There is no one in this room who is sinless. But do what you can in every way you can to trust and lean on God's teaching. And live the path in the life that God has for you that isn't always going to be pleasant. It's not always going to be easy. Oftentimes, it's going to be excruciating. And you, out of that, will be joyful. Think about that. Your level of joy today is fully dependent on your commitment to God. He gave you all the joy you could possibly experience in life with his son, Jesus Christ. And he's simply saying to you, how much of it are you ready to receive? Your joy today comes wholly and completely from your ability to commit your life wholly and completely, not just parts of it, to God. And the more of your life that you give over to Paul's teaching and God's teaching and Christ's teaching, the more you live this way, the more joy you will have in your life.